It's time for Valley Writers Read, a production of Valley Public Radio featuring the talents of writers from Central California. Here's the host of our program, Franz Weinschenk.
Good evening, friends. Tonight, two Fresno authors' perception of America. First, a longer story by Larry Hill about racism. Not the blatant, aggressive, out-in-the-open type, but, you know, the subtle, condescending, and therefore possibly even more hurtful type. And then a story by John Walk, who as a 10-year-old gives us his first impression of New York City. Here is Larry Hill's story, Modeling Fee, read by Jay Parks, followed by John Walk reading his story, Ode to Manhattan.
Modeling Fee. This morning, Rick Morris was told, he wouldn't be joining Shorty Dietz on the rancorous old spray rig. The ugly pink-coated affair hunkered in the early sun, already a scribble of heat waves from the county yard's oily surface distorting its image. "Old Hiffle's looking for you, Ricky," Shorty called. Russet head stuck out of the cab's window, hard line of a mouth, with freeze of beechnut tobacco juice. A new man sat next to him, hired as summer help, same as Rick. Rick would miss Shorty's yarns today, the narcotic monotony of spraying roadside morning glory. Hiffle? "Inspector E.B. Hiffle," Shorty said. "Don't stop nowheres to be eating lunch with the man, else you'll be up all night counting the money you spent." Rick waved at the spray rig, continued his stroll toward the pool of 1951 Chevrolet two-door sedans, cars the agricultural inspectors drove. While walking, he pondered, as he had now for weeks, about the war in Korea. This nagging thought foamed at his blonde Sears and Roebuck work boots like a cold undertow. Inspector E.B. Hiffle drove. His big, freckled fingers on the wheel suggested to Rick ripening bananas. Hiffle wore the uniform typical for agricultural inspectors: khaki trousers, western-trimmed white shirt, string tie, sweat-stained deputy's Stetson, cowboy buckle, and pointy boots. Hiffle's right hand searched the space between their knees like he was more familiar with four on the floor than with the gear lever being up on the steering column. Settling his formidable weight, he turned his mealy face to Rick. "You like working with old Shorty?" "Old Shorty's great." "He tells me you're an art student at Fresno State."
"Yes, sir."
"You must have found Shorty creative, then."
"Creative?"
"Yes," Hiffle said. Hiffle shook his pan head. "Thought that was damn creative."
"Yes, sir," Rick said. Today could run long. He'd forgotten his lunch pail back in the warehouse.
Hiffle removed his Stetson, laced his fingers through a black pompadour that crested evangelically above silver sideburns. "That new girl in the front office, believe her name is Amanda."
"Yes, sir," Rick said,
thinking the man should gear down. Jensen Avenue turnoff was ahead. August sun sweetened the hay-smelling morning. "Well, Amanda must be creative. Told me over coffee she thinks your eyes are the exact blue used in the funny papers."
"Cobalt."
"Well," Hiffle said, sweeping the wide turn onto Jensen, "don't be so nonchalant. Try to appreciate the originality behind the girl's observation."
Rick squirmed in his seat.
"We headed anywhere in particular?" "Particularly the colored district." "This man and his colors."
"Colored district?"
"Golden West side of Fresno."
"Oh,
that's a color," Hiffle said, "ain't it?"
"They'll think we're the law," Rick said, the car creeping through the neighborhood.
They passed two Negro men pushing a pickup off of a driveway.
A third man behind the wheel popped the clutch. A black woman in the next yard clutched a housecoat to her bountiful bulk and chased children onto a porch that harbored bustard tricycles under its a-tilt gallery. A spotted dog aimed rage at the county car, seemed embarrassed by his off-pitch bark, and snuck back to his property's bones. Eddies of summer swirled from the sidewalk's colonnade of maples into the car. Hiffle lifted his rump, picked his pants from the bite of his buttocks. Rick could hear the man's bowels venting. "Snooped this block yesterday," the inspector said. "Told two colored kids around here I'd be back today with a watermelon and a camera." Rick looked back at the pickup. It had yucked to life only to die on the narrow street. One black man yipped, glanced hard at Rick. Then he shook his head and grinned. The pickup's wheelman shouted out his window, "Forget it, Ordell! Push her on back up the damn driveway." What looked to Rick to be a tarp-covered upright piano teetered in the truck's rusted bed. Hiffle withdrew his neck from above the door's decal, Fresno County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. "Here we are, Rembrandt." Less baleful than its neighbors, this house Hiffle had set his sight on sat primely amidst the short streets. Rick remembered playing City League basketball nearby at Frank H. Ball Playground. Mostly black kids around. Some tough old German families, Mexicans, Italians. 2 summers ago, a tall Slav kid had punched his nose in a game. Still a bump there. He'd been warned. Play across Highway 99. You get what you ask for. From the car's trunk, Hiffle took out a camera, swung it over his shoulder, and handed Rick a clipboard. "Know your clipboard, you ever get drafted into the army," he said officiously. "Never walk a base without one, else they figure you're casual, slam you with KP detail." This from an ex-quartermaster who'd served World War II stateside. Rick had heard the story from Shorty Dietz. "When old Hiffle left Camp Gordon, Georgia, he changed his luck going back to white women." Holding the clipboard at port arms, he faced Hiffle. "Brief me on what's up, sir." Hiffle closed the trunk, rapped on it with his huge, speckled fist. "Fine-looking watermelon in here. Cantaloupes and Crenshaws, too. Still life with melons. For them pickaninnies I seen in front of this house yesterday." From up the street a youngster cried. Another laughed. A mother scolded. An old chorus Rick remembered from his own childhood, not that long ago across town. "Where do I come in, sir?" "Help me pose them for the cover of our report." Hiffle's eyes rolled wildly in his head. Them eating in ecstasy. The way that they do, you put a watermelon in their path. A dead branch fell from a stunted tree that was uprooting the walk under Rick. "Why me?" "Shorty says you can draw real good. And I seen the portrait you done of the commissioner.
Got me this summer job."
"Well, commissioner wants you to help me get a good shot you can do a drawing from."
"Might look stereotypical," Rick said. "You know, black kids, watermelon."
Hiffle slapped his thigh like he'd pocketed the church's collection plate. "Jesus! Well, let's hope so." He rolled his eyes again. "Life drawing. You draw women without their clothes on?"
"Undraped. Nude men, naked women, all day long."
Hiffle's eyes seemed spun askew like twin roulette balls. "Do me a favor, Morris." He pointed blindly in Rick's direction. "Don't ever mention that crap to me again." Rick's tanned arms stung with anxiety as he marched up to the house. Lately, he'd felt unsure about continuing college. He wondered what branch of the service could keep him from being shipped to Korea. And today, this duty with Hiffle? An old ruffian twice his age? 2 kids appeared on the porch, about 6 years old, no doubt twins. They posed shyly, barefooted, little brown toes wiggling. Otherwise, they could have been waiting for Sunday school. Bright cottons, matching wide eyes. A girl, partially veiled by the screen door, watched. Like Rick, she was in T-shirt and blue jeans,
Like the kid, she was without shoes, bracing one leg flamingo style against the other. It came to Rick that he'd never been inside a black family's home, and he wondered if the girl would invite them in. Hiffle proved himself a charming intruder, greeting the kids, explaining his mission. "Picture for our report's cover," he said, smiling grandly. "Kids are perfect." The children clamped chubby fingers over their giggles. Rick tried to imagine them eating a watermelon. Were they between having teeth and not? "Their daddy's at work," the girl said. "What about their mommy?" Hiffle asked. "Not home. I'm their aunt," saying it old style, not aunt. Rick heard the round softness of her words. Suddenly, she swung the door wide open. Rick caught Hiffle, saving the inspector's wide ass from wedging into a small wheelbarrow the little boy had shoved against his calves. A hint of a smile deepened dimples below the girl's high, plum-colored cheekbones. "My brother is Carl Mims," she stated, as if a pause was required after the name. "I'm Bev Mims." She didn't extend her hand. Thick lashes guarded her eyes as sunlight strobed her face. Her hair was an ebony fizz. Rick saw in its blackness the harsh sun. "Come in," she said. "Grandmama will want to talk with you." "Nice house," Rick nearly shouted, not yet having seen a wall, having seen nothing beyond this young woman. She graciously waved his foolish remark, along with him and Hiffle, into the mid-morning stillness of the parlor. The deep interior of the house swirled around Rick in roaring circles. His mind swam away from him, and he grew weak. "Jesus," he said, realizing old Hiffle had him under his arms this time. The wind from the man's Stetson smelled of sweat as it fanned his face. I'm fine," Rick managed. "Just didn't realize how dark it was coming in out of the sun." Hiffle handed him his clipboard. Across the room, the girl parted rich-toned drapery. All was at once afire and darkling and resonant with a song of past times. Mellowed chairs, sofa fabrics, polished hardwood, secret bric-a-brac. A basketball player stared at Rick from a mantle of sepia memories. "I know him," Rick pointed. "Edison High, about 5 years ago. My brother," the girl said. "League champions the 3 years he played." "Sure," Rick said, taking an unaided step. He felt giddy, wanted to celebrate his recovery. "We going to meet Grandmama now?" "Great, great Grandmama, actually," Bev Mims told him. 3 a bright kitchen, Rick counted pink and yellow among the colors. Window flowers casting delicate shadows against a chrome and formica dinette. Rallying with each step, he urged the twins to follow their aunt. Hiffle brought up the rear. In a room, obviously added to the bungalow, the old woman lay, a settlement of bones propped up in a brass rail bed. The twins, bolted by Rick, pounded gleefully on the high bed. "Grandmama!" Alongside him, Hiffle stiffened. "Whoa." Bev Mims calmly collected the children, shuffled them away. She returned with 2 chairs from the dinette set. "These 2 men are from the county, Grandmama." The old woman opened her yellow eyes.
"Oh, yes.
They wanted to take the twins' picture for their report."
"Shoo."
Grandmama moved her lips as if keeping time to a reluctant rhythm. Her eyes tracked Hiffle as the big man sat.
"You the cowboy done pestered my babies yesterday?"
Hiffle cleared his throat, explained once more about the photographs.
"I'm sure the farm section of the Fresno Bee will be running a copy of Rick's rendering also."
"Shoo," Grandmama said again. Her luminous fingernails tended fastidiously her gown's bodice. Her face, centered on a pillow, contained a fragile grouping of angles covered with parchment no darker than potter's clay. Hair above powder-blue temples clung like a dusting of chalky moats. Little old lady, Rick thought, sadly. Her pigment gone with time. He turned and, to his dismay, found that Bev Mims had departed. Behind the bed, on a white wall of cinder block, a framed photograph of President Franklin Delano Roosevelt watched the room. Rick thought back to open-booked homework on the living room carpet in his parents' house, to war news on the tall, slope-shouldered Philco radio, static, then the declaration of the president's death, afterward his mother's consoling touch on his back. He'd resisted tears up to the lilting cowboy song. So strange the treaties, so sad the melody of Home on the Range. Rick pointed, I was 11 when he died. He leaned toward Grandmama. You remember his favorite song? Where the buffalo roam, the old woman said, and was silent. Rick feared her voice gone, her mind too far away. A window across the room allowed for a breeze from the green-gold morning. It persuaded a tender piquancy from the bed, from Grandmama's movement to wire spectacles in her lap. She adjusted her glasses and sat up straighter. I'm 97 years old, she said, after a pause befitting her dignity. Down for my morning rest, though I aim to rise again before this day is done. Hiffle's chair groaned. Goodness, you were born before the Civil War. Oh, yes, she said. I was a slave child, you see. Imagine, just outside Atlanta when the battle come. Souls dying, souls living, then dying purely for the loss of them were dead. She lifted a long finger off her breastplate. And I've seen that again and again in my life. Oh, yes. Again and again. She swung her hand slowly and turned a stand-up photograph on her bedstand into full view. Tate Goodfellow, my husband. In the picture, a black man smiled through splotched time from a charmed, long-ago day. Man could march, she said directly to Rick. Was a flag-bearer to Teddy Roosevelt's Rough Riders young. Rick wondered in silence, did she just call him young'un? In the band. Tate was a potato man, young. Potato man. Give him a horn, they had to jam a potato on its bell so nothing come out. Man couldn't blow a note, young. No, ma'am. But damn, the man could march. Bet he could, Hiffle said. Called him Tater, then just Tate. She cracked a sweet smile, showing moist purple, ancient ivory, timeless gold. Tate Goodfellow. Hiffle sucked his teeth. Well, Rick caught a scent of stale piety on his breath. Light's just right outside for our pictures, ma'am. She paid him no mind. I've always been called Mercy, Goodfellow. Was a born nurse, though not registered till 85. Can you not understand, young? Over 65 years ago, Rick said, tapping Hiffle's freckled fist. The big man's mouth formed an astonished O. Served in the Great War, I did. Started me a clinic after. South Side Chicago. Trained whites, blacks, trained Roberta Hunter when she gave herself to the call. Have you not heard of her, young? My gosh, the singer. Oh, yes. Lord, I've seen my share of hurt souls. Seen enough to know death ain't a curse, though. Are you not agreed, young? I'm not sure, Rick answered slowly. Two of my friends were killed last month in Korea. Don't know how they'd answer you. The old woman drew in a breath. It mingled in her hollow chest. Life is not the earthly thing of soil,
nor blood of man, she said. It's but a picture of such things, a notion, young. In death the world truly abounds, and things that were of such dreams and notions become the real heaven of rivers, stones, flowers, flesh and bones. I'm going to have to remember that, ma'am, Rick said. Our work, young, is to replenish the dream for others. Dust to dust, then rejoice on his shore. Amen. Hiffle blew his nose in a red bandana, examined it scrupulously. About them pictures, ma'am. Grandmama switched her gaze from Rick to the inspector. Oh, shoo. I don't know. Hiffle pinched his nose into the bandana until his eyes turned red. And there's the modeling fee, he said in a nasal whine. The old woman pushed her palms against the thin bed cover. Her arms trembled, but she raised herself slightly. You hope to picture my babies eating that fool watermelon you're so proud of? Silence. Then Rick said, Nope. Nope, from both Grandmama and Hiffle. Nope. Rick repeated. We put the melons, we brought all kinds, in that wheelbarrow on the porch. The little girl sits atop the melons. The little boy pretends he's pushing the cart. Can't you just see that picture, ma'am? Rick saw her demure smile again. All right, then, young, the old woman said. But give the fee to Beverly for Carl come home. He find out? Ooh-wee. They pulled into the yard at 4:30. With Rick supplying the flirtation, they pried the modeling fee from Amanda in the main office. There you go, Ricky, she said, handing him an envelope. Commissioner okayed it from petty cash. $30. Rick thanked her, noticed how her brown eyes were made big as a St. Bernard's by her thick eyeglasses. Her figure brought to his mind pinup pics of Betty Page he'd studied in a magazine called Peep. Outside the office, he caught up with Hiffle, held out the envelope. Hiffle sliced the air between them with his waxy palm. Keep it. Do what you want with it. With the pictures, too. Should have them next week. Look, Mr. Hiffle, forget it, Morris. Draw the picture however you want. I sort of promised old Grandmama. No watermelon-eating shots. Hell, I couldn't stop those kids once I sliced into that juicy thing. Maybe one of the shots will work. Hiffle grabbed Rick's shoulder like it was a loose tennis ball. How old are you, Morris? 20 next month. The draft? Board says the Marines are taking the biggest numbers right now. Son, join the French Foreign Legion before you let the Marines get you. Yes, sir. And Morris? Hiffle hitched his belt with his fists, evened his neckties, rawhide strings. I ever need help again on an unusual project? I'll ask old Shorty, could I borrow you? I like your style. Then the man was off towards his newly washed, milk-white pickup. He'd whipped his Stetson off, and his dark pompadour was rocking. Rick moved off, too, strolled into the warehouse, rounded up his lunch pail. Shorty Dietz pulled on his arm. Old Hiffle, touch you for lunch! Yes, Rick admitted. Shorty spat out an amber streak into a bin of poisoned oats used for squirrel control. With old Hiffle, it's just like going to church. Did he not leave you broke? Shorty's manner of phrasing the question reminded Rick of old Grandmama. Did I not see you come from the office? Shorty asked. Was you over there flirting with Amanda? The one with the looky-there body on her? Picked up a modeling fee. Shorty rubbed his sore-looking eyes. You did what? At his car, Rick halted, waiting for a balance to rediscover his slender frame.
past heat-wavy asphalt Shorty was climbing into his old heap. He could hail old Shorty. Ask, was he stopping for a beer, Johnny's on Ventura, where they accepted Rick's doctored ID? Amanda came briskly into view. As she opened her car's door, her dress drew taut across her girly magazine haunches. Still time to give her a honk, a gesture to hold up 1 minute. Instead, Rick drove out of the county yard, south on Maple, west on Jensen. Maybe those old guys with the piano in their pickup still needed help. Ordell, he could say, let me help you start that peckerhead. Mightn't Bev Mims come out? Smile at the commotion? Glancing at the gas gauge, he knew he might not make it to the Golden West Side. Lunch had left him broke. The $30 in his pocket belonged to Carl Mims's family. He'd walk the money to Mims if he had to. Mims could accept it or refuse it. Jesus, he could, if he saw it as a violation, kick Rick's ass. Any way you counted it, Rick wanted to go back to that old house. Wanted it enough to smile and enjoy the valley's evening air as it stretched out, singed and harsh, ahead of him on the shimmering road.